spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down. The medicine go down, medicine go down. Just a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down in a most delightful way. A robin feathering his nest has very little time to rest while gathering his bits of twine and twig. Though quite intent in his pursuit, he has a merry tune to toot. He knows a song will move the job along.
Hi, everybody. This is Dr. Edward Park from Recharge Biomedical, and we're talking about colds and flus today. This is podcast number 24. First of all, what is a cold? Up on the upper right, we can see some cold viruses. These are rhinoviruses, rhino from the word nose, I guess, Latin, I would think. The symptoms are, as we know, a runny nose, nasal congestion. You can get a sore throat. And it varies whether we get flu-like symptoms, those typically being fevers, chills, nausea, headache, and myalgia, arthralgia, or soreness all over the body. In fact, cold is much more heterogeneous than flu. There are over 200 viruses that can cause cold symptoms, so it's fairly nonspecific. The way the cold sees things is it invades our respiratory tracts or through our eyes, usually from rubbing our eyes, and so hand washing is really important. And so the virus gets us to sneeze into the air, more droplets, and cough and secrete, and that's how it gets around, by using us as a host. The complications include sinusitis, which is sinus infection, which can cause headaches or even bacterial infection after that, ear infection, sore throat. Unlike flus, colds usually do not cause a fever. They usually don't cause much of a cough or a subsequent pneumonia, at least not in adults. Adults average about 3 colds a year. Children maybe more, up to 8 colds a year on average. The treatment for a cold is only supportive. You can take zinc lozenges, like cold ease, in the first 24 hours, but afterwards doesn't help too much. There are no vaccines to prevent the cold. There are so many types, and there's no antibiotics that can treat it, neither does echinacea nor vitamin C appear to help. What is a flu? A flu, in contrast, is a specific thing which, as we know, causes sometimes very high fevers. Cough is typical, and then you can also get a headache and nasal congestion, as well as aches globally, and sometimes GI upset, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. Typically, the influenza virus is called influenza A, and it comes from waterfowl or birds, usually in Asia. And the reason why there's so many different kinds of virus is that they're RNA viruses, and RNA doesn't have the same proofreading mechanism that our DNA does. So whenever they get rewritten, about 1 in 10,000 base pairs is wrong. And so even if you have a perfect immunization against a particular envelope protein, which is what the flu viruses are against, they're always genetically drifting. They're always mutating. So that's why there's always new strains. Influenza B is not heterogeneous like A. It really only occurs in humans, seals, and ferrets. So unless you have seals and ferrets around, it's generally a single disease and not that good. You can even get immunity to that because it doesn't genetically drift as much as A does. C is a mild form, and it's, again, only in people, pretty much. It occurs in other mammals, birds and mammals, but it's usually mild except in children. So the class of infections, these are called zoonoses, which means that they come from other animals and they're shared in between humans and animals. And every spring, the Centers for Disease Control goes through, I guess, Asian chicken farms and figures out what the next likely flu strains are. But of course, from that time until the fall season here, they can genetically drift. But they do a pretty good job in guessing. The reason why the vaccines sometimes wear out is that the immune response is an antibody response that lasts only about 3 months. So typically, people who maybe come in August to get vaccinated can get sick around December, and they'll say, well, doc, you know, I got the flu vaccination. What happened? Well, it's already worn off in 3 months. So word to the wise, you might want to get immunized a little later, perhaps October, in order to cover the height of the flu season, which is generally about November through February, the winter months. Drugs that definitely work are Tamiflu. These are neuraminidase inhibitors. Neuraminidase being, if you look to the left, there are these proteins on the surface. Hemagglutinin is how it binds to the cell. It replicates itself, pumps out a bunch of little viral packages, and then buds off again. And one of the steps here in budding off is neuraminidase. So there are a bunch of drugs like Tamiflu that can inhibit that step. And so, like anything else, prevention is better than cure. So it would definitely be a good idea, if you're worried about the flu, not only to consider vaccination, but to have some Tamiflu lying around, because by the time you call your doctor and he checks his messages, calls the pharmacy, you pick it up, you've already got a very rapid, aggressive reproduction of the flu in you, and it's too late in many cases. So better to have that in the fridge and nip it right in the bud, because they are effective. Looking at the bottom of this picture is a little bit of nomenclature. You know, the flu viruses, they're generally A. So it would be A. This is the part in China where it comes from, Fujian. And there's a strain number as well as the year. So it's a logical sort of naming convention. And then the subtype or the species within the the influenza virus is H3N2. What should we know as patients? Warning signs. Okay, this is very important. The flu replicates all over. It should be a whole body disease. You should feel miserable from head to toe. If it localizes to one organ, that's bad. And also, the flu should be self-limited, maybe up to 2 weeks at most. Persistence is bad, too. So, for example, if we have labored breathing as a clinical symptom, this could indicate pneumonia. And, of course, pneumonia can be both bacterial and productive in a cough, or it could be what they call walking pneumonia, which is a viral pneumonia. Stridor is this kind of high-pitched, croupy cough, like a kind of like a chicken choking. Keep in mind, these are bacterial in origin. Haemophilus influenza, strep pneumoniae are bacteria that infect the epiglottis, or like the little lid on top of the trachea. And so what's the relationship there? Well, the virus can compromise the immune system, and then the bacteria come in it. It's a super infection. So people say, especially at Kaiser, they could be quite dogmatic about not over-prescribing antibiotics for viral disease, yes. But within a single host, certainly it's plausible, and it does happen, that antibiotics can help shorten or limit the damage to the host, even in a viral disease, for this reason. Wheezing is that high-pitched sort of wheezing that asthmatics get. This is also not a good sign, as it can cascade into really difficulty. Another problem, neurologically speaking, is if the headache, which is often attributable to sinus congestion behind the eyes, the forehead, the cheeks, if you start getting a headache with a stiff neck or difficulty looking in lights, a photophobia we call it, that could be a sign of a meningeal or lining of the brain and spinal cord infection. And this is bad. So viruses that can seem flu-like can actually be something else more sinister. For example, equine viruses that can cause meningitis, and that obviously can be very dangerous. Another sign, going back to respiratory, would be thick green sputum, which can come from either the sinuses or the lungs. Again, this is definite indication for antibiotics. What can also be affected is the heart. So you can get cardiomyopathy. a gentleman called me last week, a physician, who had a flu-like symptom, and then he began to be short of breath, and turned out he went into pulmonary congestion because his heart was so affected and the muscles started to waste that the pumping was so inefficient, it pooled, and a clot went to his brain. So he actually ended up having a stroke from having a global heart infection. And of course, there are other viruses, adenoviruses, other that can cause this sudden episodic heart failure. GI distress, also, you know, rotavirus or other enteric viruses can cause flu-like symptoms, and it's part of the what we call the differential diagnosis or the short list of possibilities. But keep in mind, if you've gotten antibiotics, they can also be related to a form of infectious diarrhea that is selected for after taking antibiotics, called pseudomembranous enterocolitis, or it's caused by C. diff, but that's common. And if you have a persistent foul-smelling diarrhea, it's crampy, you know, days to weeks after your cold is gone, you may have gotten that as a result of taking antibiotics. Also, skin rashes, it's not uncommon to get what we call viral exanthems or eruptions. If the rashes persist or if they're associated with, you know, unusual focal arthritis or joint inflammation, it could be a sign also of collagen vascular diseases such as lupus, scleroderma, rheumatoid arthritis, and it's thought that many of the autoimmune diseases could have a viral cofactor etiology. Again, idiopathic, meaning that we don't know what it is, so even 20 years ago when we were in med school, they told us if it's idiopathic, it could be viral or autoimmune. Those are also all kind of synonymous. So how does a body get rid of viruses in general? This is a T helper cell, which really coordinates everything. So once the T helper detects a virus, it clonally expands. This is an important principle. Clonal expansion means the one guy reproduces himself into a whole legion and so on and so on. So this is so that we have all the things in the library, but say, you know, all the kids are doing a book report on Julius Caesar, you can't have them all checking out the same book at the same time. You have to get millions of copies of that book at the same time. So that's what a T helper will do. It'll clonally expand, and its role is to coordinate cytokines, which are these factors that I forgot to mention here. Cytokines are interferon, tumor necrosis factor. If you go back to the hepatitis webinar 10, Daryl talks about how awfully felt on this interferon. This is the stuff that sets up this huge cascade of inflammation, which makes you feel awful when you get the flu. Everything aches. You just feel terrible all over. These are the cytokines, and also the cellular damage triggers more cytokines. So unlike the cold, which is relatively benign, the flu triggers these awful cascades and you feel terrible, which is why flu-like symptoms is a nonspecific way of saying, usually implying viremia or a lot of viruses in the blood, and the cyto police here, and they activate macrophages, which are these garbage disposal guys that come in and they identify infected cells, eat them, and destroy them. They also coordinate the other side of the immune system, the antibody response. So if you want to make antibodies against a certain influenza virus, T helpers will coordinate that clonal expansion of those antibody-producing B cells. And they'll also produce chemotactic factors, will bring killer T cells, again, killer T cells being specific activated T cells to kill off this viral threat. I did about a year ago, I did a blog posting, and if you haven't seen the blog postings, they might be worth looking at. There's a lot of more terse and, you know, compact little reads on subjects such as maximum lifespan, what cancer therapy. This one I entitled AIDS is Aging and Vice Versa. And it's meant to show something very profound, actually, that in the middle of the chest, up top the breastplate, is this organ called the thymus. And the thymus is what the cells are named after, T cells for thymus. And in the thymus, your T cells, which come from the bone marrow, go here to get trained, and they get trained to be active killers, and then they get deselected by apoptosis to become not too gung-ho that they'll kill the host. And as we get older, even in the time of the ancient Greeks, Galen, about two, three centuries after Christ, knew that the thymus was smaller as we get older. It's relatively big in children and almost gone in older people. And that's because our immune system are like blank keys. And as we get older, we run out of those blank keys. Why is Jekyll Lane in a cold and flu lecture? Well, Jekyll Lane is a health pioneer in terms of exercise, which is a telomerase activator, nutrition. He had that juicer that he sold. But he died actually a year ago yesterday, I learned, January 24th, at the age of 96. So how did Jekyll Lane die? Well, he didn't die. The barbells didn't fall on him. He didn't have cancer. He didn't have a heart attack. It was a cold that he ignored, or not ignored, but, you know, he didn't get on top of it, either personally or in terms of the immune system. It overwhelmed him. It blossomed into probably a pneumonia, and this is not uncommon. If we look at a study last year, 2001, in the Journal of Gerontology and Biological Medical Sciences or something, what they did was they looked at this cardiovascular heart study. They had blood samples from 92, and they looked at the same people 5 years later and said, well, what can we say? It's a fishing expedition kind of study, not a randomized controlled trial, but nonetheless a valid cohort prospective study, we could say, because they didn't know they were looking for anything. And when they adjusted for age, race, sex, the people with the shortest telomeres versus the longest were 60% more likely to die during that five-year period. And why? Well, they pulled out all causes, like it wasn't cancer, it wasn't dementia, it wasn't stroke. None of that was significant. It was 0.07 in the p-value. But what was a 7 out of 1,000 chance of being random, meaning it wasn't random, was death due to infectious etiology. So that's the tie-in with Jack. So if you have a person who's 100 or 110, and they've proven their ability to survive cancer, their cardiovascular system is intact, what's going to kill them? Well, the common cold and flu. And we see this, and you can plot this out with children as well. This wasn't really looking at children, but it's a bimodal. It's kids die of the flu, old folks die of the flu. So as we get about 65, why do we die of the flu? Well, you know, the respiratory tract isn't as resistant. But by and large, it's just immune senescence, meaning your immune system gets old. So it's possible that AIDS is aging, and aging is a form of AIDS. It's a form of acquired immune deficiency. As we get older, the immune system, which is charged with killing all our defective cells that turn cancerous, it runs out of those blank keys, and eventually we succumb. One study out of the David Geffen School of Medicine at UCLA, the leading expert is Rita Efros, who has this theory and is the leading expert on immune senescence. And so what she did was take this telomerase activator from the Geron Corporation, the makers of PA65, and she took these T helper cells that were infected, I'm sorry, these T cells that were HIV infected, and she exposed them to a telomerase activator. And she found that it slowed their telomere shortening, increased their replicative potential, enhanced their activity or their function, and their antiviral activity. But if she put a telomerase inhibitor in, that effect was negated, meaning it was specifically due to telomerase activation. And this is graphically represented here. A telomerase activator tattoo from the Geron Corporation kept T cells younger, meaning after 40, 60, 100 days in culture, this is the non-treated, and this is the treated, these cells were able to double more. They were longer. They had more survival because this is in keeping with the theory of replicative senescence, meaning every time a cell copies, the telomeres get shorter, it gets closer to death and dysfunction. And again, it was mediated by keeping their telomeres longer. So again, looking at how many times they had doubled, let's say we take 100 days out, this culture, this colony is doubling 20 times. At 20 times, the ones that weren't treated, the telomeres were only 5,000. The ones that got the tattoo, there were 10,000, meaning this is exactly how the immune system was kept younger. And this may have implications for us, for HIV, for cancer, because, of course, the main way that we fight viruses and the main way we fight cancer is through our healthy T cells. another study with the help of Dr. Joe Raphael, who is the original collaborator with TA Sciences, and here Cal Harley was the chief science officer of Geron for many years, Maria Blasco, the leading scientist of telomere science based out of the Cancer Institute of Spain, and Bill Andrews, who is the founder of Sierra Sciences and a guest to our webinars. They did this study of the first 100 people on the patent protocol, and somewhere in here is my dot, I don't know which one, but I was patient 19 to sign up for the patent protocol. And what they did was admittedly a fishing expedition, but they drew blood and a bunch of tests, and what fell out of the data was this. We have blue dots, which are CMV uninfected folks, and red dots, which are CMV infected folks, and the linear regression looks like this, meaning as we got older, the number of CD28, which is strictly a measure of the burnt out fraction. These are burnt out T cells that can no longer do their job. Got slightly higher in the older a person was. So I'm probably here, and I got a lot of very few burnt out cells. Here are the CMV infected folks, and their line is a little more steep, and they regress to this mean. And so as the older folks in the CMV group had more burnt out fraction of T cells. And that stands to reason because CMV is a chronic infection that we live with, that we fight off. It's like barbarians at the gate. And so this grinds your immune system and ages you faster. So when they further looked at the data, this will be a final edit of the podcast. What they found was that the natural killers, which are indicative of a burnt out immune system trying to do its best, they went way down. The fraction of burnt out CD28 negative cells went down. The neutrophils went up, meaning active cell killing. And so this was within those first 100 people that experimented on themselves with the patent protocol, dramatic improvements, especially in the CMV positive group. So what can we say? It's possible that for those 100 people taking the telomerase activator, that their immune system, by virtue of this telomerase activation, chromosome protection, was rejuvenated or restored, or the dysfunctions were killed and replaced, and as a result, they reaped some benefits to their immune function. All right, as we always do, let's turn to more anecdotal stuff, which you can roll your eyes if you like, but one of the interesting things I've gotten from treating hundreds of patients is this report of a weaker cold. And very common that people say, you know, come to think of it, I got this cold. It kind of was in the back of my throat as a tickle, but it never went anywhere. And we know that typically a cold will last days to a week. It will blossom into, you know, nasal congestion, sore throat, some mild flu-like symptoms. But no. What Chuck, who appears in our sleep dysfunction webinar number 9, talks about is that it was strange. And the only reason people talk about it is that it is so peculiar. You go your whole life, 8 colds a day or a year, and you know what a cold feels like, and then all of a sudden this strange thing happens. So let's listen to what he talks about. Hang on one second. Here we go.
You know, I thought I was sick. And but I didn't, you know, I was getting scratchy throat. It didn't, like, it was almost like a silent cold.
I've gotten that one a couple of times. Yeah, it starts in the throat, and you're expecting the other shoe. You're expecting the aches or the runny nose,
right,
or the cough.
Right.
It just doesn't come, right?
So I call it like a silent cold. I can feel there's a bug in there.
Yeah.
But
it's very common, actually. I've never had that before taking K2, but it's just like it starts, but it never goes anywhere. You just get rid of it.
Yeah.
Well, that's because your T cells, your immune system is so much better, stronger. So.
Okay, so Chuck was alluding to the fact that he doesn't have that great immune or lung system. His father, unfortunately, passed away from small cell lung cancer. He was a heavy smoker, and that's a good segue to talk about our friend Jackie Close, who was I see Marianne English, who is on the call right now. Hi, Marianne. She found us on the internet and was looking for a way to help her friend, Janet. And so she introduced us to Kathy, who found out about the webinar I did about Jackie Close. So that's how the web sort of works. And Kathy, of course, is the mom of Lulu, the black lab, who is still disease-free, thank God, after a year of metastatic osteosarcoma. So I would really ask you to check out podcast 4, Lung Cancer, and then the one we did in memorandum. Jackie passed away, unfortunately, from further metastasis from her small cell lung cancer, but amazing person. And one of the things that kind of came out of her testimonial was she had a beautiful extra year that she never should have had, in great health, wonderful skin, just loving life. And unfortunately, they left the original cancer in because they figured she wouldn't be alive past 6 months. And right at the two-year mark, brand new metastasis overwhelmed her. Nobody would take out the original, you know, dandelion flower, so to speak. So that was really sad. But she did die without evidence of the huge golf ball metastasis, both in her spinal column and in her brain, which is interesting. And she was also a TA65 user. But she had the small cell cancer. She went through cisplatin, carboplatin, etoposide, big, heavyweight chemo. And the first year she did that, she couldn't even leave the house. She was so run over. But after taking TA65, she had so much great energy, she moved in to help raise Tracy, her daughter's kids. And this is a little comment that I recall when we interviewed her about the kids running around in the Chicago winter coughing with the flu. And this is what she said. She looks amazing. Did she get a lot of colds this winter? I know last year she couldn't even leave the house, or in 2009. Was she sick a lot?
I don't think so. No. Like, we've had a flu that's run through all the rest of the kids. She hasn't gotten it. And all the rest of us have been sick. So, no, I don't think so.
So, and I hear that a lot from chronic users of TA65. They don't get the colds and flus. If they do get the colds, it's a mild version. So, again, I would suggest possibly related to an improved immune system. And that's a transient effect. Again, it keeps those T cells healthy and active. But, you know, the T cells, the whole blood system is on a constant grind. And so as we get older, that may be one of the reasons we do get older, is that the T cells, our ability to even blood cells is impaired. So that concludes the slides. We have the ability to take questions now. Let me handle the first question from Robert. How long on a full dose of TA65 does it take for the immune system to improve the most? Unknown. We really don't know, but it seems to be a continuous positive effect based on some of the slides that I'll put into the edited presentation. But the longer the better, and the more the better. So it is accretive as time goes on. It's not just temporary phenomenon. You do literally start growing younger, I think, and part of that is the immune system gets younger. One thing that people ask, well, why do people get colds in the winter? Some people believe that it's because there's less humidity in the air, and so the particles can hang out more. When there's less humidity in the air, they can go farther and live longer in the aerosolized state. Another question that's asked is, do you get a cold from being cold? Is that a wives' tale? Well, I think you do get a cold from being cold, and no one has really figured out why, but obviously when you transition, I mean, if you're used to being cold and you're all bundled for it, no biggie, but if you're going hot to cold, cold to hot, probably there's something in the temperature regulation deep in the hypothalamus that affects your cortisol synthesis, and cortisol is one of the major modulators and mediators of the immune system. So who knows why, but, you know, that's one experiment. Classic example, you don't need a randomized controlled trial to know that if you go out with, you know, wet hair and a T-shirt after sweating in the gym, you're probably going to get a cold. I don't know. It's pretty sensitive and specific. The positive predictive value is high. Although scientific dogma being what it is, people get really angry when you say, "Well, where's your evidence?" Well, okay, whatever. Question from Mark Robinson. Similar question. I have low neutrophils showing up in recent blood tests. I've been using TA65 for 1 month at a time. Mark, you got to let us know what happens. You know, I had a gentleman contact me about his father with myelodysplastic syndrome. If you figure out what that is, it's just broken chromosomes. And guess what causes broken chromosomes? Telomere shortening. So there's a specific syndrome, although there are other things that can cause this pre-leukemic condition. And, you got these supposedly immortal hematopoietic stem cells in your bone marrow, and, you know, they get typographical errors, they get problems, they get older. So just like all the diseases, eventually your spare parts run out. You need to get replenished, you need to kill the dysfunctional ones, and a lot of times the damage is not cleared either by the cell itself or by the immune surveillance. And so one of the ways that T65 could be helping would be to help those damaged cells go through their final self-annihilation. But, you know, everybody's different. You really can't say whether you'll get better or worse. So we look forward to hearing from you. I mean, every person is their own case study. This is much more like anthropology or law. A lot of it is anecdotal. Now, going forward, we're going to have some randomized controlled trials, and then we'll garner a little more respect. But, you know, this is not just because we don't have a randomized controlled trial. I mean, you don't have to have, you know, 100 white Broncos and gloves to determine whether OJ was involved with, you know, I'm not saying he was or wasn't, but that's how law is practiced. Every case is its own anecdote. So, admittedly, we don't have the rigorous scientific evidence. Now, having said that, I wouldn't consider this to be a non-study. This is out of the Geffen UCLA Medical School. It's an experimental study, and it is looking at a telomerase activator and HIV-infected cells. So that's science. Likewise, it's a fishing expedition if you don't know what you're looking for, but nevertheless, the data unequivocally, this drops out. And so it's suggestive and plausible, and people always love saying, well, you can't fool me, Dr. Park. I know this is just anecdotal. And but, you know, there's 24 webinars now with crazy anecdotes, so you be the judge. I mean, again, you can hypothesize that people are all falling under my magical Jedi powers and believing some placebo effect, or you can just look into it and judge for yourself whether there's anything there. But somebody asked me yesterday, hey, why don't we have 10-year studies? Well, okay, who's going to pay for that? If the drug company can't own this and make money off it, why are they going to spend $10 million getting it through the FDA when anyone else can extract it and sell it? That's probably a non-starter. I mean, people have been taking astragalus for 2,000 years. So that's a pretty good safety record. I mean, unlike the things like thalidomide, they have a good record, bad record, they're refurbished. This is something that comes from nature, and it's relatively safe to take. So, you know, on the other hand, there's been maybe 16 billion people who've done the experiment of not taking a telomerase activator, and it's highly likely that if you don't, you will get older and sicker as time progresses, despite being healthy and exercising and eating well. And the plausible explanation for that, again, is telomere shortening. Question, why not create 501c3 to make TA available for more people? Stella. That's a good question. Actually, that's something that I've been talking about to a few people who know how to do that, a patient of mine, some of the people on the board of Polk Hospital, and Sophia, who's on the call in Sun City Anthem, Henderson, Nevada. She and I are in the process of doing just that. We want to set up a nonprofit so people can adopt a senior. Because there are a lot of people who spent their life maybe not making money, but whose karma is so good that they deserve to live on and teach us. So I did reserve a URL called greatsouls.org, and my idea is that maybe, like they do with Save the Children, you could sponsor a little kid in some village. In this case, you could sponsor a senior citizen, say a lady who survived Nazi Germany, but now doesn't have the money to buy TA65. If something in her story resonates with you, you can sponsor her and establish a connection and watch as she improves her health and life and continues to contribute what she knows. So greatsouls.org, that thought has been in my mind for about a year, and so hopefully we can get some people who with the talent to make that happen. I have quite a few hats on right now, but I would like to see something like that, because people are always saying, well, I just don't have the money, I can't justify it. And we all know that a lot of people spent time doing other things that are worthy besides just amassing material wealth. So it's a way of rebalancing the karma, I hope. So, can you share with me or us what you said to me about like the third, fourth night about the dreaming? You figured something out. What did you mean by that?
Well, you know, I didn't even have to figure it out. That was the total blessing of it, was that I went to bed and I, you know, like you had said, you know, I woke up at a certain time and I just went right back to sleep. And then I woke up probably around 5 o'clock in the morning and felt like it's time to start the day. And I said, no, you need to just rest a little more. So I went back to bed, and that's when I had this dream. And the dream was a resolution for me. I wasn't even thinking about this, but this resolution came to me about a level of relationship with people. And I'm, you know, I'm in my late 50s, and I feel like I'm going through some changes. And it was like editing relationships, and it became so clear to me how to proceed. And not that there was anything to do. It was like an undoing. Things, like you said, got easier.
It's interesting. Yeah, you can't underestimate the importance of those hours between 3 and 6 in the morning when your procedural memory is running. Your body's healing, but you're also remembering the declarative memory, the faces, the phone numbers. But that's when your subconscious, right, your psyche, your spirit, your mind, your fantasies, your fears, they all work through issues. That's why if you're particularly nervous, then they can be like Hitchcock films. But if you're blissful, they can be really fun. People say, oh, I look forward to dreaming because it's fun. But also, you know, it's that old thing where you're using your subconscious to figure out issues, problems. And that's really what dreaming is. A lot of people with very traumatic lives, they repress their dreams. So whatever was on the back burner for you, all the pieces just kind of fell together, I guess, like a Sudoku or something like that. Well, that's cool. That's not the first time I've heard that, actually. People thinking about who are inventors, like Stella, a lot of times sticking to TA helps their intuitive side be more efficient as well. Yeah, that's cool. Anything else you're feeling since starting? You've been on, what, like a month?
No, just like not quite 2 weeks. You know, I never would have noticed before that I wasn't so well-rounded.
Thanks. Talk to you later.
You're welcome.
Bye. Any other questions before we sign off? Sophia. Let me unmute Sophia. Wonderful. Sophia is a news reporter from Sons of the Anthem. Hello, Sophia.
Can you hear me?
How are you?
Hi.
I can hear loud and clear. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to say also on the quality of sleep, I really feel the difference. Actually, the first 3 nights, I could feel like every cell in my body is kind of a little bit vibrating. It was a really interesting feeling how I became aware of my cells. I sleep a lot deeper. And what I realized the last 2 nights, I have in dreams of from my childhood, like with friends or some that unresolved things, like an emotional hurt that I kind of pushed away, and I dream with those now, and people I even forgot or I haven't seen for 50 years. It's really interesting. Yeah, I think that's probably very important, because you know, with the emotional baggage, we cannot really rejuvenate. So this is cleaning that one out also, which is great.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's great.
A spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down. The medicine go down. Medicine go down. Just a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down. In a most delightful away. A robin feathering his nest has very little time to rest while gathering his bits of twine and twig. Though quite intent in his pursuit, he has a merry tune to toot. He knows a song will move the job along.